No. There we go. Good morning, fellas. Good to see everybody. Is Jesus in the house?
Yes.
This is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and
be glad.
Got a couple things I just wanted to share with you this morning quickly, guys. Just a minor thing. You guys all know about what we call our opportunity card. I have some people that say, you know, I still like the old type cards that listed all your meetings and all those other things. The group is going so fast and growing so well that the whole reason is to obviously drive guys to the website. When people write all week long and say, I want to know about the ministry, just tell them to look at the website because everything you need is there. Okay? I just want to share that with you. So first of all, I wasn't supposed to be your facilitator today. It was our good friend Shaw back there. And for those of you who were here last week, when Danny spoke on the state of the ministry, he did an awesome job, don't you think? We just love what we do. We had the opportunity a couple weeks ago to speak on a nationwide podcast called the No Regrets Men's Ministry. And they asked about why ISI is successful. And I talked about all you guys. And I told them, it doesn't have anything to do with me, it has to do everything with the Lord, and that you guys sharpen each other and share it with each other. So we're going to post that tomorrow or Monday if one of you guys, if you'd like to watch it. But I wanted to talk to you this morning about two quick things. First of all, what does an Iron Man look like? This Iron Man right here is Eric's Gross. Eric, are you here? Stand up if you are, buddy.
There he is.
Stand up.
All right.
And the reason I show this to you. This is from the trilogy Living magazine. I've known Eric's for about 5 years now. You never met a sweeter guy, just a wonderful servant. And they talk all about him. And of course, ISI, what's so important is to be a blessing to others at home, working in the community. So again, let's thank Eric's for all that. So fellas, what I want to do this morning, let me pray for you first. Lord God, we're grateful just to be sitting here this morning with all these men who come in and love you. Some guys are doing fantastic, Lord. Some guys are doing just okay. But the whole point that I'm going to talk about for just a couple minutes before we bring on our amazing speaker is about the fact that you are our hope, and we need to put all our trust in you and not look elsewhere. So, Lord, let that just permeate this group this year as we move forward. In your name we pray, amen. So I want to talk to you guys briefly just a little bit about affliction. Affliction, I talk to you about that sometimes. Psalm 119, longest psalm in the Bible, says, it's good for me that I became afflicted, which also means troubled. Because if I didn't become afflicted, it says, I wouldn't have learned your laws or your statutes or your rules. So we've been looking back, especially as the Bible studies are now entering in the book of James, which is fantastic. And I also want to address and thank our main leaders of the Bible study, Jim Gergerich and Tom Groth. They do a great job, don't they? Over 120 guys a week in Bible study. Man, that's just unbelievable. But anyway, Psalm 119, being afflicted. So being afflicted can be many different things. It can be illness, physical illness, and thank you for all those who you know, prayed for me while I was out, and so many of you have had physical illness the last month. It can be spiritual warfare that you're afflicted with. It can be emotional problems. It can be other things in your family. So sometimes I think back and I look at trials. We talked about trials a lot in James this week. And look at the trials that you've had in your life. And do you really now embrace them? Because when you're in the middle of those trials, you don't see that the Lord's really taking care of business. It's not till you look back years later and you see that he was with you. In my case, the last couple weeks, I knew the whole time that he was carrying me on his back. He was pulling me across the finish line. And he was pushing me, whatever it took to get me there. I had no doubt whatsoever. And also, in a couple weeks, I'm really excited. Our friend Von Barnett sent me something, but also David Jones will be speaking. And we're going to sing one of the greatest hymns ever, and we're going to blow the roof off, Holy, Holy, Holy. So does anybody not know Holy, Holy, Holy? If you don't know it, you're going to know it by the end of that day. I promise you. And I'm going to have another guest up here speaking with me, singing with me. But anyway, so the point I wanted to make is affliction. How do you deal with affliction? How do you look at your trials? Do you embrace your trials and realize that the Lord was truly there the whole time? And what was he trying to teach you in the middle of that trial? That's the hard part. When you're really down in the dumps, what is he trying to teach me? And I find at the end, we talked about it this week, embracing the trials gets you past that hump of things that used to really cause you pain. Because we can't move on well in life, guys, unless we let go of past failures and heartaches, right? And a lot of us have trouble letting go of the past. Can I see your hands? Got to move on. Got to move on. I promise you that the Lord is your only hope. Scripture that I told the guys in Bible study this week that means so much to me is Isaiah. The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He won't grow tired or weary. And his understanding, no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weak and power to those who are weary. Even young men, this whole group, may stumble and fall, it says. But those that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint. Who remembers that from the movie Chariots of Fire? Remember Chariots of Fire? If you guys haven't seen it, 1980, best picture, you should definitely see that. I want to read one more scripture today and then turn over the podium. But last night, when I was told I was going to open this morning, I said, Lord, I don't know what to say to the guys. I want to thank them for prayers. You know, when you're afflicted, unless you reach out to a brother or some of the guys you're meeting here, you're walking alone, man. And you guys know in this ministry, one of our sayings is no man walks alone. That's a choice. And it doesn't have to be that way. I want to read for you just, this is like this morning when I was out walking, I said, Lord, what do you want me to say to these great guys who I love so much? And it brought me back to Colossians 1:15, the supremacy of the Son of God. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. You know how we talk about in our ministry, God has to be first in your life. Has to be. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross for you. Once you were alienated from God and you were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. Anybody fall in that category? But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation, if you continue in your faith, established and firm, and do not move from the hope held out in the gospel. Whatever you're going through, whatever your affliction is, he is the hope. He is the hope. This is the gospel that you've heard and has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, and of which Paul, the Apostle Paul, has become a servant. So I just want to encourage you guys today, whatever it is, if you just look to God and look to the men around you, you're going to get through it. Because as it says in James, one of my very favorite scriptures, blessed is the man who endures trial. For when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, eternal life, that God promises to those who love him. Let's give the Lord a good clap this morning, guys. Thank you. We've got a wonderful video that to introduce our great speaker today, and I want to thank our friend Dave Schultz for bringing Steve with us today. So let's run that video.
stream, every sunset sky. But my one request, Lord, my only aim, is that you reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams, in my darkest hour.
Because life is full of obstacles.
Meet Steve Lillis. He has fused his passion for pool and for people into his own gospel trick shot ministry. Steve remembers getting his first pool table as a kid.
On Christmas morning, I was so surprised, and my eyes must have been open like saucers because I saw that beautiful 4-foot by 8-foot billiard table with the shiny balls and the green felt.
That year, Steve also gave his heart to God.
And it was around a campfire that I gave my heart to Jesus. And with the fire burning on a beautiful summer night, I prayed to receive Jesus at the age of 11.
As he got older, Steve honed his billiard skills and by the age of 20, became a paid professional in the sport of pool, touring across the country with a desire for more fame and fortune. But life in the spotlight left him with some tough decisions.
I compromised my faith and my principles and my upbringing. And so I found myself in a place many years later that I really didn't want to be in.
And that place forced him to see the futility of his celebrity lifestyle. Steve recalls the night that changed his perspective, an encounter with a very famous baseball player.
I was actually in Las Vegas at a blackjack table. And he was playing blackjack, actually hiding out from the media. And I met a few other very, very famous people, you know, in my travels along the way, and particularly that year. And I saw the emptiness that they had, and I didn't see any joy. And I thought, wow, this is what I'm chasing?
That's when he surrendered it all.
I symbolically laid my cue stick on the bed as I knelt and said, Lord, take my life. Take my game, take every part of me, do with me what you want. I'll never play this game again unless you call me to. And 12 years later, he did.
Steve teaches novice pool players like myself to execute tough trick shots. Then he delivers the message of Jesus Christ right on cue.
Steve now tours professional pool events, college campuses, spreading the gospel with the game of pool.
This shot is called the Chattanooga Choo Choo, and this shot means a lot to me because it was in Chattanooga, Tennessee, back in the early 1980s that God began to really work on my heart. And what we're gonna do here is take the caboose, the four ball, and we're gonna go around the table with the caboose and hook up to our train.
Steve uses the game of pool to share the gospel around the world. He's even landed back on the professional tour, but not in a way you might think.
I kind of evolved into the pastor of pool, if you will.
And while this pastor doesn't preach from the typical pulpit,
so the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross,
he knows what can happen when people put their trust in God.
As I put God first, and as I seek God first, that he gives me all the desires of my heart. You see, God knew my heart back in 1985 when I surrendered my game and my life to the Lord Jesus Christ. He knew a secret desire was to play this game that he had given me a talent to play. Seek Jesus first. He knows what you want and what you need, and he'll give it to you if you put him first.
Am I on? Can you hear me?
Yep.
Yeah,
Boy, I'll tell you, you guys are awesome. You are here at 7 a.m. to meet Jesus, and that's my kind of men. So I really appreciate the opportunity to be here to speak. And yesterday I was at the Bell Center over here in Sun City. Was anybody over there watch my show? Was anybody here? No, I don't see anybody. I guess they saw enough of me on the pool table yesterday. Yesterday we had a great time. I did a show there sharing the gospel and the recreation center there. And and I was up in Wickenburg the week before, the team roping capital of the world up in Wickenburg, Arizona up there, and did four shows up there and shared the gospel at the American Legion, a saloon, a bar, and Vulture City. Vulture City. It's a new, with the Marshals shootout at the OK Corral kind of thing. So it's just a privilege to be here today. And, you know, I've been thinking about what I want to share with you guys, what the Lord wants me to share with you guys. And Ted talked about afflictions. And that's very near and dear to my heart. I have had 4 heart surgeries in the last 2 years. I've had 2 eye surgeries, and I'm getting another one the end of this month. So, you know, it's good that I have been afflicted. You know, the Apostle Paul said that. That's not me. It's good because I've been on my back a lot the last 2 years, and I needed to be on my back. I needed to get in line with God's priorities and what he wants for me. And, you know, I've lived life in the fast lane for a long time. And, you know, pool was an idol in my life for many years. And I needed to come to grips with that. You know, it became my badge of independence. I was part of the 60s crowd. Anybody here from the 60s? You know, where a lot of them were chasing after peace and love and Woodstock, you know, I decided to take my cue stick and travel the country and drop out of society and be an underground pool player, and then eventually as a hustler and a gambler, and then eventually a top tournament player, played in many world championships. But I wasn't doing it for the Lord. And so God had to get my attention. And I was raised in a Christian home. I'm from New Jersey. And I was I had 100 scriptures memorized by the time I was 11 years old. I belonged to Stockade Christian Service Brigade, it's called. And I don't know if anybody's familiar with that out here, but very popular back where I'm from. And so I knew the right way to live life. I knew kingdom priorities in my head, but it wasn't in my heart. And when I got to be 16 and a hotshot pool player, I went my own way. And I became the classic prodigal son. And God had a lot that he needed to teach me starting at age 35. And it started at my wife and I, she was a professional pool player too. And so we took off together from New Jersey and we traveled the country playing professional pool together. We had a 10-year honeymoon playing pool and traveling northeast, southwest, wherever we wanted to, wherever we went. And we lived a kind of a charmed life, you know, for 10 years. And that's what the video talked a little bit about that. But I realized that was not adding up. I didn't have joy. You know, joy is spelled J-O-Y. Jesus first, others second, yourself last. And see, I had it totally backwards. I was first. Others, they were just a mark, somebody I could take money from. And Jesus was more of a curse word, you know, when I miss a shot kind of thing. So I had no joy. And people wanted my autograph, and they thought, oh, this is great. You are fantastic. I want you. But it was empty. And so what God did is my wife and I, we were very much in love. After 10-year honeymoon, we decided to stop and have children. And then life changed. The party was over when the children came. And now what happened is the pressures of having children and getting a straight job, if you will. I was 35 years old, and I never worked a day in my life until 35 years old. And so I started working and providing, and pressure was building with my wife and I until finally she left. She took the children, and she left me. She said, "You're not the same person anymore. I married a pool player. I don't know who this person is," because I started giving my heart to the Lord. And I started trying to live for Jesus, but I was doing it very legalistically. You know, I was trying to fix her. You know, she used to say to me, "I see you got your Mr. Fix-It pants on today." You know, I didn't get it. You know, I was trying to fix her. I was trying to make her live by the Bible. You know, and because I had so many years to make up for all the wrong things I did, and I don't know if anybody can relate to that, but I became very legalistically about the Word of God, you know, and I did not have love. It wasn't done with love. And, you know, I've been in a personal study in 1 Corinthians, you know, in my quiet time. You know, I do devotions with my wife in the morning, and I'll get back to when she left, but now we're back together. I have a book in the back. I don't want to, this is just, we were separated for 19 and a half years. When she left me, and I went on to become a college professor, it's all in this book. I went on to start the ministry, Gospel Trick Shot Ministries, because God told me not to divorce her. She was off doing her thing with the kids, and I wasn't seeing the kids very often. But she, after 19 and a half years, God brought her back to me. And when she came back, she said to me, "You know, God took me away from you so we could have a worldwide ministry." Yeah. Yeah. And you know, it took 19, I was so hard-headed, it took 19, and even though I was doing the Lord's work, it took me 19 and a half years to learn how to love a woman, you know, away from her. And now we've been back together for the last 15 years. We have two daughters. We have six children, grandchildren, I should say. One of them's in heaven. We lost one in a horrific automobile accident. Did I say that it's good that I've been afflicted? You learn a lot through pain and suffering. You learn a lot, and I really appreciate Ted bringing that up because, you know, when my granddaughter was killed in the accident, and it made national news, by the way, it was horrific, and I got to see it on the news. That's how I got the news, you know, horrible way. And I was faced with four choices when that happened. And, you know, Satan's in one ear and God's in the other ear. You know, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities, against spiritual wickedness in high places. You know, and the battleground is your mind. You know, and so the four choices that filled my mind as I heard the news was, okay, who did it? This person, who's responsible for this accident? You know, and then I realized, well, God, your priorities are that you want me to forgive. How many times? 70 times 7. So I'm only going to end up having to forgive this person. So I realized that I can't make that choice. I can't, because, you know, when you have unforgiveness, it turns to bitterness. It's like drinking poison. It'll kill you. So I didn't choose that option. The second choice that was in my ear, Satan and God. Satan's in my ear, and he says, "Well, how could you do this? How could you allow this? What kind of a God are you?" And then I remember the story of Job. And by the way, I was a world literature professor for 24 years in English composition back home at William Patterson University in New Jersey. And I taught the book of Job as part of Hebrew literature. And Job lost 9 children. And he said, "The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." Why did he say that? Well, at the end of the book, you know, he realized who was in control of the universe, who laid the foundations, who flung the stars up in the sky. God's got absolute control of everything, including your life and my life. And so I realized I couldn't choose that option to get angry at God. And then there was a third choice that was whispered in my ear. This is payback for all the bad things you did when you were a gambler and a hustler and a womanizer. This is what you deserve. Well, Jesus was in the other ear. And John 3:17, everybody knows John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. Whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. But that next verse is sweet. And I needed that in my ear. It says, for God sent his Son to the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. So if I don't condemn you, Steve, don't condemn yourself. So those three choices, and you know, when you and Jesus faced on the mountain, the three temptations, right? And what did Jesus do when Satan approached him on the mountain in the great temptations? He quoted the word. The word was in my heart as a child, came out just at the right time. And so I chose Romans 8:28. All things work together for good to them that love God, to them are called according to his purpose. Hallelujah. Praise God. You mean you're even going to work this out for good? You're going to work this out for good? Even this? And the Lord said to me also, you walk by faith and not by sight. Right? So I didn't have the answer how he's going to work it out. Maybe you're going through something today. He wants you to take a step of faith. He wants you to walk by faith and not by sight. Don't look at the appearance of thing. Man looks at the outside. God looks at the heart. He wants you to trust him and walk in faith. Whatever your struggle is, whatever your affliction is. 2 years ago, I was laying on an operating table. I didn't know if I was going to live. 99% blockage in the Widowmaker artery. Widowmaker artery, whoa. And the doctor said, we found the problem. We're going to save your life. And I look up and I said, it ain't you. It's the Lord. God was using him. Jesus said, let him who's sick seek a physician. Okay, doctors. Are there any doctors in the house? Thank you. Thank you. But it's God. He's in control. And so I said, Lord, let me come back to where I almost died on the pool table 2 years ago in Sun City. And yesterday I came full circle. I prayed on the operating table. Let me go back there and share my testimony with those people in Sun City where I almost died 2 years ago. And I was there yesterday sharing it. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But let me get back to my wife, and let me get back to this concept of love, kingdom love. You know, my wife gave me a hard time when she left me. You know, and the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 16:14, I said, I've been studying that, and I realized at the end, the last chapter, do all things, in everything you do it with love. You're to do all things. It's 1 Corinthians 16:14. It's right at the end. And I was staying at my sister's up in Wickenburg this past week, and I did something, and I'm reading the Bible every night before I go to bed, but I did something unloving with my sister. You know, we're kind of familiar with each other, you know. We grew up together, and you know how that familiar spirit when you know, she knows how to push my buttons, I know how to push her buttons. I don't know if you can relate to that. You know, she knows my weaknesses and my flaws and my faults, and I know hers. And sometimes, you know, the chemistry, you know. And so I was very, for lack of a better word, rude, you know, to her. And then I went into my room, and I'm on the last chapter of, and I'm in the study Bible, and it's 1 Corinthians, last chapter, and do all things with love. And I realized I wasn't very loving to her. And so I sent her a text. It was late at night. You know, sometimes you have to write it or you send a text because they don't want to see your face. You know, maybe that's the best way to break the ice. And she received it, and then she drove me to Sun City the next day, and all is well. And we're going to England next month together. I served in the military, by the way. I played pool for the United States Navy. Yes, sir. Special services, yeah. They put me in special services, and when I was in the Navy, I beat the champion of the world and got a lot of publicity for the Navy. And the Navy did far more for me than I could ever do for the Navy. So I'm going to do shows for the Air Force in London next month, and I've done shows for the 5th Naval Fleet in the Arabian Peninsula and returning vets from Afghanistan and Iraq. So I'm all in for the military. Wherever they need me, I'm on call, you know. But getting back to this concept of love, I believe that the afflictions that I've been through, you know, have taught me how to love better. Because if you don't have love, you have nothing. You know, you can have all gifts, talents. I've got gifts, you've got gifts, you know, and I've had to be humbled. And, you know, there's a few verses I wanted to share. And I want to give one example. I don't want to take up too much time here. I only got a few minutes left. But when one of my daughters got remarried, and this had to do with she lost a child, and she got remarried to a guy that was not very loving. And I was forced to, he basically threatened me and said, if he got a lot of money from the accident and all this kind of stuff, and he thought he was hot stuff, you know, kind of a young punk. Like I was. And my wife would say to me, well, what were you doing at that age? Well, I was a punk too, you know. And so I had to learn how to love him unconditionally, because he would threaten and say, I don't know if you've been through like this, if you don't do what I say or how I do it, or you see, you know, you're out of here, you're not going to see your grandchildren. You know, so I had to learn to love unconditionally. And I remember some of the words of Jesus when he said, love your enemies, bless those who curse you. Pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. That's in Matthew 5 in the Sermon of the Mount. And that's what was happening, you know. And every time I'd go there, I would, my skin would crawl, because he would just be so obnoxious and rude. And God said, love him. Love him unconditionally. Just keep loving him. And so I would get up, and it would diffuse them. Love conquers hate every time. Love conquers. Love is the greatest force. So I want to encourage you with your relationships, you know, that to love those who are unlovely. And, you know, there's another verse I wanted to share here. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things that you have need of will be added unto you. You know, when we default to love, kingdom love, under the most adverse circumstances, whether it's a relationship, whether it's you're on your back with sickness, with whatever, try to find ways to love unconditionally. And that means you know, love doesn't know, and again, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, love doesn't know when it's been wrong. Love is patient. Love is kind. You know that verse, that famous love chapter. And, you know, I know that God's had to teach me this through affliction. So I thank God for the afflictions. And, you know, I got, you know, the Proverbs, I wanted to share this other verse too, because when my wife and I got separated, you know, before I left, there was a proverb God gave, because it became unbearable. And there was a proverb that said, it's better to live in the corner of a housetop than a wide house with an angry woman. And I remember just before she threw me out, reading that, and when she threw, and you know, 19 and a half years later, she came back to God and to me. And, you know, because I learned how to love her during those 19 and a half, I served her whenever I could. You need any milk for the kids? You need it. And I didn't grow up with my kids. She took them away. But God worked it all out. And so I have some questions on the board. We have some questions. Yeah. Are you making kingdom love your priority in all your relationships? And I have a shot called obstacle shot. You heard it on the video. You know, life is full of obstacles. What obstacles are keeping you from realizing your God-given potential? Okay, and what adjustments do you need? I have another shot on the pool table called adjustments. What adjustments do you need to make to line up with kingdom priorities? And again, I'm going to close with, it is good that I've been afflicted. God bless you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Steve. Steve Lillis, let's hear a big ISI. Thank you for him. Please.
Ted, I have my books. If this book here is my journey. If you see the fork in the road, when you get to the fork in the road, Yogi Berra said, take it. That's walking by faith. And my second book back there is, I've been to 35 countries sharing on a pool table about the gospel, about Jesus. And so I've got these two books. They're yours. Take them. If you want to donate, I got a donation box there. It goes to the ministry. We're going to England next month, and then beyond that, we're going to Tunisia and other countries. And
thank you,
God
Steve.
Bless you. Thank you, guys.
But again, for Steve. You know, I didn't know till this morning that I was going to talk even a little bit on affliction. And then he comes in and talks all about affliction. Man, I had just had the goosebumps the whole time. What a blessing. What a blessing. Thank you for coming. So I'm going to ask you guys, because we're a transparent group here, if you're afflicted in any way this morning, physically, emotionally, spiritually, financially, with kids, with addictions, I'm going to ask you to stand up. Let's go. Come on. Let's be real with each other. If you're afflicted in any way, Steve, come on up here with me for a sec. Lord Jesus, let's stretch our hands out, guys. Stretch your hands up to the heaven. We thank you for this time this morning that we could all be here together. There's no accidents. There's no good luck, circumstance, or fortune with you, Lord. We ask you to bless our friend Steve who came. We ask you to continue to heal his body so he can continue to spread your word throughout the world. Lord, for each man here that's afflicted today, remind him that you are the answer. It's not what we see, Lord. It's you working in the unseen. And we either trust or we don't, Lord. And we're all in. Love these men, Lord. Bless these men. Bless Steve and his ministry and his friend Dave Schultz. For it's in your precious name we pray. Amen. 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 Guys, let's break in our groups, five or six. Let's go. Great day today. Come on. Great day.